Merci. Ah, il faut demander à Francis.
So the next speaker is Francis Bach, who is a researcher at INRIA and ENS, École Normale Supérieure. And okay, we have some time switching the slides.
C'est bon, si c'est sur la suite. C'est bon, je l'ai mis, c'est ça, il y est. Ah, toi, tu veux un deuxième.
Je laisse pas ta clé.
Je la laisse, parce que je
laisse.
Où est le plein écran? Voilà.
Okay, so first I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me here. So today I'm going to follow the steps of Emily and Lorenzo and talk about optimization. And what I'm going to present is joint work with Eric Moulin. So some of you are experts in optimization here, some of you are not experts, but what I am sure of is that many of you have complained that your algorithm is too slow. Okay? And today I'm going to try to explain you, it may not be the fault of your algorithm, maybe the fault of your own problem. Okay? And the goal today is to try to see what makes a problem difficult, what makes it hard, and if possible, try to avoid this hardness and be robust to ill condition. So just the setup, so given the talks this morning, I won't need that much time to do this. So we consider large-scale supervised learning, where we learn from n observations in size p. So this is, now we have many problems with both P and N being very large. So this is true in computer vision. Each image has a million pixels. You have a lot of images to learn from. This is true as well for, of course, advertising. This is where the money comes from. Okay, so where P here is the size of your search history, and N the number of clicks or the number of clients for Google. You also have bioinformatics, so you can also save lives with such techniques. So this is not really the topic of today, but if you replace images by proteins, you get very similar problems in terms of machine learning. You have a lot of proteins to learn from. Every protein is a complex object. So at the end, what works for images also often works for bioinformatics. So in that context, when you have a lot of data, you want to learn in a fast way. So I'm going to focus a lot on running time complexity, and the goal being to run in O of Pn, Pn being the size of your data if you make no assumptions regarding the data. So the nice or sad thing that we're going to go back to very, very old methods, and maybe I added a new slide, which is the retour aux sources. So this is a computer from the 50s. Okay, it was big, a full table, it was ugly, it was slow, it was expensive, and at the end, so the computers were very small, data were also small, but the computers were very small. Now we have like very fast computers, are pretty, are a bit expensive as well, but not as expensive as this one. But now the problem is that data are too massive. At the end, it's a very different problem, but for us, when you design an algorithm, it's the same thing. We have too much data, and we're going to go back to the simple techniques, which will make a single pass through the data. So this is the outline for today. I will first spend quite a bit of time introducing the problem and the algorithm, stochastic gradient, and its average version. And then I will go over strong convexity. So this is a quantity that will make a problem easy or nice, or well-conditioned or ill-conditioned. And then I go over recent work with Eric Moulin, showing to be robust to this lack of strong convexity. So the setup, I'm going to consider n observations xi, yi, xi being the input, yi being the output. You can think of xi as being an image, and yi as a real number coding the presence or absence of an object in an image. And I assume I have n observations, which come id from the same source of data. I'm going to consider only linear predictions. So as Lorenzo mentioned, not linear in my input, but linear in some features which I assume can be computed. If you wish, you can take the last layer of Jan's neural network and you apply this to the last layer if you wish. So at the end, you have phi of x, which may be high dimensional, and we want to learn as a linear function of those phi of x, and theta is parameterizing this linear function. I'm going to consider like empirical risk minimization, where I want to minimize the sum of a data fitting term. So this is very classical. So I have a loss between my output and my prediction. And throughout the talk, I will assume that the loss is smooth. So this will include least squares and a logistic regression. You add some regularizer, but in fact, in that talk, I will select mu equal to zero, so there will be no regularizer, in fact, in this talk. So there are two quantities of interest when you do machine learning. There is the first quantity is the empirical risk. This is what you can observe at training time, so you want to make this small. But what you really care about is not the performance on your training data, but the performance on your testing data. So this is the expected value of the loss between the output and your prediction, but over unseen data. So you have an expectation over X and Y coming from the same distribution as your training data. So given this, the goal is to, you have access to this and you want in fact to minimize this. So there are two big questions that people have been answering the last 50 years or even more. The first one is a pure optimization. How do I compute theta hat, a minimizer of the things? So since I've assumed I have a convex problem, then this should be easy. And the second problem is how can I analyze the results? So this is a statistical question. How do I make sure that if I minimize this cost function, I'm going to do something correct for that testing cost? So those two are often taken separately, and the main theme of the talk is that you can do this at the same time. So a bit of definition. So this is after lunch, so let's start slow. So I'm going to assume my functions are smooth, and essentially this will mean that they all have bounded second order derivatives. Okay, so this is the Hessian of my functions. And all the eigenvalues will be less than the constant L. So on the left, this is a smooth function. On the right, this is a non-smooth function because you have a kink over there. Okay, so very, very basic, smoothness assumption. In the context of machine learning, when you take that cost function, okay, if you assume the loss is smooth, and we do here, by assuming we have either least squares or logistic, then this corresponds to having a Hessian which is proportional to this, and having this bounding from above essentially means that you have a bounded data, which we will assume throughout the talk. So an upper bound on the eigenvalues of the Hessian is not a big assumption. The big one is a lower bound on the eigenvalues. And this is a strong convexity. So if you assume that your function is twice differentiable, you're strongly convex if only if all the Hessians have eigenvalues which are lower bounded by a certain mu, okay, and mu being non-zero. So on the left, this is a convex function which is not strongly convex because you have a flat part. So this part is flat. So on this part, the Hessian is equal to zero. So you're not curved in that direction, so you're not strongly convex. So here, you're strongly convex because you are curved in every direction. I will show examples in 2D which may be more intuitive. So what does it mean for machine learning? Okay, again, same similar cost function. Okay, if you assume that the loss itself is strongly convex, and this is strictly convex, this would be the case for least squares and logistic, then you need to have a lower bound on the eigenvalues of the covariance matrix, of the empirical covariance matrix. And here you hit a very big assumption. Why? Because if you have more dimensions that you have observations, so if p is bigger than n, then this matrix is always rank deficient, so you never have strong convexity. So at the end, you should think of like high dimensions, low number of observations being leading to a non-strongly convex problem. And this has been noticed by many people. And I say, oh, if it is not strongly convex, let's make it strongly convex by adding some regularization, like Tikhonov. But the problem is that if you do this, you change your problem. Okay? So since you change your problem, you need that mu to tend to zero to avoid adding too much bias. So in this talk, following Lorenzo, I will do regularization by early stopping. Okay, so now a small review on classical methods for optimizing smooth functions. So I have any convex function G. This is gradient descent, so you go down the direction of the gradient. We have seen this already a few times. And the quantity that will characterize the speed of convergence of those techniques is essentially strong convexity. So if you have a strongly convex problem, this means you are curved in every direction. And on the left, you have a typical example of a super strongly convex function. It's like the square norm. Okay, so in all directions, this is the contour of the function. So all contours are circles. So essentially, the Hessians are all identity. And if you launch gradient descent from any point, in one step, you reach the global optimum. Okay, it's a super, super well conditioned. So this is where you have like what you call like exponential convergence rate. You converge very quickly. Whereas if your function is not strongly convex or have a very small value of mu, you're more in that situation where you have some directions over which you have a long valleys. And if you launch gradient descent from that point, you're going to oscillate a lot. So what you can show is that as soon as your function is convex, you won't converge linearly, but you get this convergence is 1 over t, which is much slower, both in theory, and this also appears in practice. A key point is that you don't need to know in which case you're going to be in advance. The method is adaptive. Okay, so you run the exact same code, and depending on your problem, it's going to be fast or slow. And in fact, you can show that there's not much you can do about it, that if your problem is ill-conditioned, all methods will end up being slow, unless you, of course, precondition a bit. So this is gradient descent, and then you have Newton, where you replace this, scalar gain by a matrix gain. So now you are robust to ill conditioning, but you have to invert a system, which might be a problem when p is of size 1 million. So the main theme of my talk follows the nice insight of Léon Bautou and Olivier Bousquet. I think there are two important insights. The first one is that since we do machine learning, our cost functions are averages. So since averages tend to oscillate with a width of 1 over root n, where n is the number of elements in the sum, it's useless to optimize up to machine precision. So if you use Newton, you can easily get with like 20 iterations to machine precision, but this is useless because you end up optimizing over the noise. So first insight, we can have like slow techniques for optimization. And the second insight is that we don't optimize any function g. We optimize a sum of functions. Maybe we can leverage this to get faster algorithms. And it is essentially the topic of stochastic approximation. So what is the goal of a stochastic approximation? Is to minimize the function f, which you can't observe. Okay, so it's a function f. You only observe noisy versions of the values or of the gradients. So this is very general in applied mathematics. In our context, we're going to have a very specific setup where what we want to minimize is directly the testing error. So the error on unseen data, which I refer to as the generalization error, which is the expected value of the loss. So this I can't observe because this requires infinite amounts of data. What I can observe, however, is a loss on a single observation. Okay? So if I take the expected value of that loss, I get my testing error. So now you can guess what I am going to take as a noisy gradient. We're going to take the gradient of the loss over a single observation. So accessing one noisy gradient requires accessing a single data point and computing the gradient, which is over there. So you have you take your features, and this is a number. Okay, so at the end, the access to a single gradient is independent of the size of the data sets. It only depends on the size of the gradient. So what is the classical algorithm? It's not gradient descent, because I only observe a noisy version. It is called stochastic gradient descent, or often a Robbins-Monroe it's a version of Robbins-Monroe algorithm, where you go down the one gradient, one noisy gradient. You have this modification where you do averaging at the end, which was mentioned already by Lorenzo. And finally, the key question is, what should the step size be? So if you have ever played with stochastic gradients, this is not a simple thing. So if you look at the papers from the 70s or 60s, I'm sure you have read that the sum of gamma should be diverging and the sum of gamma squared should be converging. So typically 1 over n would be a good step size. This is a good step size only for very well-conditioned problem. So if you're strongly convex, sure, you can use this. But for any problems in high dimensions, this will converge arbitrarily slowly. And people have seen that you should have a bigger step size, so a slower decay of the step size, more 1 over root n. So this is essentially summarized by existing work. So people have shown that if you take stochastic gradient, the key quantity that will characterize complexity, like in the deterministic case, is strong convexity. So if you have a well-conditioned problem, So when mu is not equal to zero, you can get a convergence rate of 1 over n mu. So here, what I mean by convergence rate is the rate at which I obtain the best prediction over my class. So I'm assuming I'm doing linear predictions. Okay. So if I consider the excess error on top of that best predictor, it goes down to zero as 1 over n mu. N being here both the number of iterations, but also the number of observations. If now, and this is obtained by stochastic gradient, and if now I happen to have a hard problem because it's very, very large, I'm not strongly convex, or the value of mu might be very small, then I get to 1 over root n convergence rate, also achieved by a stochastic gradient, but now by a different step size. So here, from the start, we lose adaptivity of the algorithm. You have to decide in advance if you're going to be easy or not, and typically in practice this cannot be done easily. So this is the first line of work, and that line of work also provides lower bounds of complexity. So in the sense that you cannot beat, if you don't, if you have like non-smooth functions, then it's not possible to beat this in general, okay? So this is one set of results. The second set of results is by Polak and Judisky and Rupert, and they exactly show the role of averaging. So now, if you assume that the problem is smooth, okay, you make one extra assumption, and if you're willing to have only an asymptotic result, like the behavior when n is sufficiently large, then with any step size between 1 over root n and 1 over n will lead to robustness to ill conditioning, but only at the first order, meaning that when n is finite, you can have bad effect due to ill conditioning. So the goal of today, it's trying to see if you can merge all of this and get a single algorithm. Don't need to decide in advance if you're going to be hard or not. And if possible, anyway, behave always with a good convergence rate, which is 1 over n, okay, but with not the appearance of mu. Okay, so the goal is to improve on everything by having 1 over n in all situations. So we're going to achieve this by first going back to least squares. Okay, so this was shown already several times today. So you take the square loss, and in that context, stochastic gradient descent is often referred to as LMS, least mean squares, and this has been studied a lot in the last 50 years. But typically with a decaying step size, often with a decaying step size as 1 over n, and typically by assuming that your data are invertible, or the covariance matrix of your data is invertible. So what we propose with Eric Moulin is first to use a constant step size. Okay, so no decay at all, not 1 over n, not 1 over root n, just constant. And what we were able to show is that if you use averaging, so if you assume your data are bounded, is a classical assumption, if you assume the noise is bounded, if you take that step size, that does depend on the radius of your data, which you assume known. If you make no assumptions whatsoever on the eigenvalues, we were able to show a result like this. So what does this show? So F is my test error on unseen data. Theta star is my best predictor in my class. This is what I'm committing when I decide to do linear prediction. This is the best I can do. Theta bar n is my average predictor, and we have expectations because the data are assumed to be random, so it's expectation over that over the data. And what we were able to show is that it goes down as 1 over n, and there is no appearance of n whatsoever. So theta 0 here is the initial point, which is classical in that setup. You have a bias term, the rate at which you forget initial conditions, and you have a noise term, which for the experts is optimal. So the dependence sigma square p over n cannot be improved in general. So how much time do I have left? Okay. So just to give you an idea of where this 1 over n comes from, I'm just writing out the recursion, which was already also in Lorenzo's slides this morning. Is that, for, like all stochastic approximation algorithms, the iterates form a Markov chain. Okay, but the key here is that because the step size is constant, this Markov chain is homogeneous, so meaning that the dynamics is the same at every iteration. So like all Markov chains, they, of course, with some assumptions, like all like homogeneous Markov chain will converge to a stationary distribution, which I will call pi of gamma. So the idea here is that starting from a theta zero, you go, and then you oscillate, okay, at the end around a given point, which I call theta bar of gamma. Okay, so just by the fact that I'm using a constant step size, I will never converge. Even if I'm at the, even if I think I'm done, one step will drive me away from any point, so I oscillate, and those oscillations are known in advance, and I call theta bar of gamma this expectation. The magic here is that for least squares, this theta of gamma is the global optimum. So at the end, I do oscillate around the global optimum, and with this will not be true in other situations. So now it's almost done because this is without averaging. So without averaging, I'm going to oscillate like randomly around my true optimum. So now if I do averaging, I'm going to converge quite quickly to the global optimum. This is known as the ergodic theorem. If you have a converging Markov chain, the average, any average, will converge at rate 1 over root n. And since I'm considering like squares to quantify convergence, I get 1 over n just by the setup of my problem. Here there is no computation whatsoever. You get like this 1 over n convergence rate just because of the setup of having a constant step size plus some averaging. So here, of course, the work is on what is in the big O. Okay, so we spent a lot of time trying to find what is in the big O, and this was the previous part. So let's look first very big data, p equals 20. So here, n is n is the number of iterations equal to the number of observations. This is distance to optimum, both in log scale, and here in dotted, you see the non-averaged algorithm, and in plain, you see the averaged algorithm with several step sizes, like three values of the constant plus a decaying step size. So what you can see for the decaying step size is that if you don't do averaging, then it does converge slowly. And as you do averaging, you get like a nice convergence, but only after many iterations. Whereas if you use a constant step size, you never converge. Okay? So if you do constant step size, you will never get convergence. So it may look like a very bad algorithm, but as soon as you use averaging, you converge quite quickly. And if you look very carefully, the slope of that line is minus one. So it just illustrates the fact that you have a convergence rate as 1 over n. So this was like fake data. So we applied it to semi-fake data, namely benchmarks for machine learning, where the size is not super big, but starts to be decent, and you get to see the effect of having large amounts of data. So here there are two lines because I've used two data sets. So this is like the alpha data set, which is over there, small number of dimensions, and the new data set, which is a large number of dimensions, but a lot of sparsity in the features. So why do I have like two columns? It's because typically when you present a new algorithm, you have the one with the bound and the one which works well in practice. Okay, so on the left, I've taken like algorithms with the bound, the step size, which is like listed in the theorem. Okay, so I'm comparing two. Let's only look at two of those. The green one, which is a constant step size. No, the blue one, which is constant step size over there, and the green one, which is a decaying step size. So on the left, I take the step size from the bound, and on the right, I optimize the step size after a few iterations, which is a common trick in when you apply those techniques. So first look on the left. If you take the decaying step size, which is a standard thing that people do in machine learning, whether you use 1 over root n or 1 over n, this will be very slow. Okay? Typically, bounds are very conservative, and if you apply the step size from the bound, it's going to be very, very slow. For the decaying step size, if for the constant step size is not the case, you converge quite quickly. And in fact, if you allow yourself to optimize the step size, it doesn't make a big difference for us because we already have a good step size, whereas for the square root step size, if you want good performance toward the end, you have to increase the constant C by so much that you start by diverging. So this just highlights the fact that the decaying step size is really bad. You want a big step size, both at the beginning and at the end. And this is what is highlighted in that setup. So to finish, can we go beyond these squares? So I mentioned advertising. So I guess they don't use, I guess Nicola mentioned it this morning, logistic is a key, and logistic is not his squares. So can we do something for that case? So if you start from the same Markov chain interpretation, since you have a constant step size here, you can follow the same reasoning. You still have a Markov chain. It is still homogeneous. It still is going to converge to a stationary distribution pi of gamma. But not a problem is that the gradient is not a linear function anymore because I'm not quadratic, and I cannot invert like integrals and gradients. So what you have is that the same reasoning as before, a Markov chain oscillating around a value which will and you will converge quickly after averaging, but to the wrong value, okay, which is away from the true value. So at the end, the reasoning that we had is not applicable anymore, and this is visible in simulations. Okay, so exact same simulation, but I replaced the square loss by the logistic loss. So I get similarly, if I don't do averaging, I don't converge. This is as before. But now if I do averaging, the curve like stops moving, so it does indeed converge, but away from the global optimum. So this is this was noticed before, that if you do constant step size, stochastic gradient does not converge. And what we have been able to do is to restore convergence. And by the interest of time, I will avoid 5 minutes. Oh, okay, I can describe everything. So I can do it without any computation, okay? So this is, how can I restore convergence? Namely, how can I make sure that that line goes like this? So in fact, there is nothing to do. Now we all have the knowledge that is required to to be able to converge. So this will be using Newton methods. So there are four facts that are known and which we can combine to get the converging algorithm. The first one, this is like earlier work. If you use stochastic gradient descent with a decaying step size, you're robust to ill conditioning. You get a slow rate, only 1 over root n, but it works for all convex functions. What I have just presented, second fact, is that if you use a constant step size, you get fast rate in all cases in terms of ill conditioning, but it only applies to quadratic function. Okay. Third fact, if you use Newton, okay, so one step of Newton is known to square the error at every iteration. Okay, so this is well-known aspect of Newton methods. This is why you have quadratic convergence. At every iteration, you square the error. Last thing, what is a Newton step? A Newton step is essentially minimizing a quadratic Taylor expansion around a certain point. Okay, so in fact, a step of Newton, it is a linear system and can be seen as minimizing a quadratic function. So now you can combine those four together. Why? Because you're going to start by this algorithm. Okay, it's 1 over root n, so it's decent. And we're going to apply a Newton step on it. So if you apply a Newton step on it, you're going to square the error. So you will go from 1 over root n to 1 over n. So you get the 1 over n. But the problem is that you can't do a Newton step. So what is a Newton step? It is minimizing a quadratic function. So we're going to use our LMS technique to minimize approximately with error 1 over n that Newton step. So at the end, we get an error which is a square of 1 over root n because we square 1 over root n plus the error made by doing an approximate Newton step. So at the end, it gets 1 over n. So of course, there's a lot hidden behind all this, in particular, the way you can do it with O of P. So whenever you mention O of P, you have to be careful, and we're able to get this still one O of P by just using the fact that we use linear prediction, so the Hessian is rank one. So I will skip this, but at the end, the algorithm is just one line modification to stochastic gradient descent. Now with one over n convergence for all loss functions related to logistic regression. And now we're able to repair the convergence by essentially avoiding this and being able to get something like this. And if you want to know more, you can look at the paper. So to conclude, so I presented that this constant step-sized averaged stochastic gradient, which was able to get robustness to ill conditioning. So this was just like this for least squares. There's no need to do anything new. But if you want to do something beyond least squares, we had to design a new online Newton algorithm, which works well both in practice and in theory for logistic regression. There's also nice work which I have not mentioned, which is dealing with finite amounts of data. So all the bounds and all the algorithms which I have presented are all assuming you have an infinite data stream and you only see data only once. And if you want to see it more than once, you can use other techniques. And there's nice work by Nicolas Leroux and Mark Schmidt. And in terms of extensions, I think there are many, but I'm putting the ones which I think are still important and still quite open. Thank you for your attention.
Okay, we have time for a few questions. So,
So just a quick clarification. Yeah. In the plots, when the x-axis,
yeah.
is that so the solution you get for increasing amount of data, or you pass over the data more than once here?
For the two experiments, it's only one pass.
Okay.
For the real data sets, it's several passes. That's why they don't go to zero at the end.
Okay.
So about your the last thing you presented, your online Newton, it seems you're getting something for free which you should pay. I mean, it seems a bit surprising.
Oh, free lunch? No, free coffee.
It seems funny. There is some free lunch there. So maybe if I can make my question precise, if your problem to begin with is not strongly convex.
Yeah.
The Hessian of your Newton step can be arbitrarily badly conditioned,
yeah.
right? And so somehow that should impact your rate? Or should
take take least squares, it's easy, okay? So at the end, you go back to the full thing. So the Hessian of the problem is proportional to the covariance matrix. Ah, sorry. Let me get it back here, okay? So at the end, you will never be able to converge pointwise, so the iterates will never converge. But since you care only about the function values, all eigenspaces of that will contribute equally. That's why you have sigma squared d over n, and not sigma squared over mu. The magic is that you don't want to converge pointwise. You only want to converge in terms of function values.
Any other questions? Let's thank the speaker again. And now this is time for the break. Until 5 to 4. Thanks. 5 to 4.